Welcome back to Filter Hose. We're going to explore some things in the advanced menu. With a new copy of the program open and running, we're going to start on step one. And instead of hitting load and selecting a measurement file, this time we're going to manually input a measurement. So try the advanced menu and slide down to manual input data. And this is going to let us insert the data into Filter Hose manually. For example, if you had an RTA measurement and you just had some numbers that you recorded off of a plot, you could type them all in here one at a time. Or maybe you have something that looks like this, a bunch of text that was exported from something like SysTune. So this has the frequency values, the magnitude, and it has no phase data in it. Now notice that the values do not have a separation with a comma. So over here in Filter Hose, I'm not going to check this box that says use a comma as a separator. That's a really important thing. If you do it wrong, you'll wind up with one box here full of all the data, and that doesn't work. Each of these values needs to be in its own cell. So we're going to select the data, and I'm going to make a mistake on purpose, and you'll see that that's not a problem. I'm going to accidentally select everything in this text file. Come over here to frequency, which is the first cell, and hit Control V or paste. And you'll see it looks just like my text file. It's all there. But we don't care about this stuff at the top, right? We just want the data, which starts on line 7. So I can select lines 1 through 6, right-click, and tell it to remove the selected rows. So just like in Excel, they're all gone now. We'll scroll down here to the bottom of the data sequence to see if there's anything else we don't want. And we can remove empty rows. And it got rid of all the stuff at the bottom that we didn't need. In the center of the manual input window, we have some choices that we need to make. The first thing to point out is the sample rate. Now, this is not the sample rate that you collected your information. This is the sample rate that you want to have for whatever piece of hardware or software you're creating the FIR. So let's say, for example, what we had measured had been something other than 48,000, and I want 48,000 in Filter Hose to do my work, then I'm going to just select the one I want. You can almost ignore whatever this was and just use the one that you want. The next choice here, target N, I think is best to explain in that this adjusts the frequency resolution or the interval between data points in the frequency response. So right now it's at 11.7 hertz. And if we had an interest to deal with more low frequency resolution, we might drive this up higher. And now you see that the data points are going to be spaced 5.8 hertz and so on. So this can get to very, very fine resolution if for some reason you needed that. The next interpolation choice is going to calculate the points between the data points. So this is the information we gave it, and Filter Hose is going to figure out what are the points in between those data points based on three different choices. The quadratic and cubic choices will result, if you will, in a curvier line. So if you have data points that are really far from each other, let's say, for example, you were just using information from your handheld RTA unit and you only had third octave data or octave data, you're probably going to want one of these choices. But if you have really fine resolution, we have a lot of data points here, then the linear is probably just fine. The next choice relates to phase. Now, we don't have any phase, so we should uncheck this, and then we're going to make a choice. One is to select phase equals minimum, and we're going to try that real quick just to see it. So if you had a device measure that was a single driver, something like a subwoofer, you could presume that the phase should be minimum phase even though you don't have the information. Then Filter Hose is going to give you a good approximation of what that should have been. If you select phase equals zero, then it just simply becomes zero. That probably applies really well in this case because the information we have over here, by the way, you can slide this over if you would like to see all the decimal points. The information over here represents an average response from several measurement points in a system. There's no way really to have a meaningful phase value in that case. Now we're going to just tell it use phase equals zero so that when we get our information over here into the Filter Hose, we'll see phase is zero, and then later as we make changes, all those changes will be relative to zero. It'll be really easy to understand what's happening as you're making choices to your filter design. Once you've decided how to set up all these parameters and you're satisfied with it, send is sort of an important decision point then because that's somewhat permanent. The manual input is complete, and here in the top left and right windows we can now see that the values we've loaded have been interpolated, and they now represent this red magnitude response. Phase is zero, it's a nice straight flat line. On the left side is the impulse response, and there is information at the beginning and the end of this window. So we're going to shift this slightly to the right. In this case we're going to use 200 samples and shift to the right. Now you can see that phase has made a bunch of phase wraps, but we don't really have any interest in them in this case because we're only going to make a magnitude change in our filter. So we have another choice over here on the right. We can right click on this window and there's the graph setting choice. You have the option to show or not show the phase response. So we're going to just turn it off so that it's not distracting. Close this. Now we're going to choose our filter or target. This is step two. The drop-down here has a choice for a user-defined target. In the previous video, we had used a predefined filter. This time, we're going to define our own. This window steps us through the process to do that. The first thing is to take note of the nominal level. Note that over here, the center of this information is somewhere around minus 20 or 30. Filter hose is going to look at the mid-range here from 500 to 4,000 and come up with a nominal level. That's sort of arbitrary. You don't have to follow that. In fact, you're probably going to want to change it. But you should be aware of where it is at the very beginning before you make any other changes. So here, minus 28 is the nominal level. And if we refer to this graph over here, we would see minus 28 is right around here at 2 kilohertz. So you're going to have to make a decision about where you want the nominal value to be. Maybe you want to make steep cut corrections that bring it down to this level or this level. And that would be kind of extreme. Or maybe you want everything to balance around this point here at 5,000 hertz. Or maybe you're really concerned about where it begins to level off from someplace over here in the base response. Whatever that is, look for that value and then set the nominal value here, the bottom left of the user-defined target screen. In this case, we're going to leave the nominal value at minus 28 and begin to define the filter. You'll see here there's a high pass and low pass already there. If I were to uncheck the bypass buttons and then press the refresh button, they would both appear. At the minimum on any target that you define, you do need to have both of those. Otherwise, the software is going to try and make a correction to the information here at the low frequency or high frequency portion of the magnitude response, and you're going to get some filter that does some extreme correction that's not practical. And I have three high pass filters I'm going to load. Basically, we're stacking them on top of each other. The first one's going to have this Q of 0.71, and the high pass is going to be at 200 hertz. Type that in and hit enter, and you'll see that the graph moved. Now, to stack right on top of 200 hertz, I can right click on the line that you want to duplicate, and I'm going to duplicate the selected, and you'll see that it inserts another line with exactly the same parameters and the graph updated accordingly. I'm going to do that one more time, and then for this third entry of this 200 hertz high pass, I'm going to move the Q up a little bit to a value of 1. So we have a fairly steep high pass filter that we've defined there. The low pass filter that we're using is at 18,000 cycles. We're going to leave that alone. That's fine. I'm going to right click on the last choice here and add one more filter. And this one's going to be a low shelving filter. I'm just going to put that there to put a little bit of low frequency emphasis. So this one's going to have the Q of 0.71. Notice bandwidth updates. If you prefer to think in bandwidth, by the way, load a value here, it'll update the queue accordingly. And for frequency, we'll do this at 600 hertz and a gain of 2 decibels. So you'll see a little bit of an increase here. If it was important to you, you could also match the values so that from minus 15 to minus 65 is duplicated here. So you could do that. This could be 65, this could be 15, and for some people that's just easier to see the comparison that way. I know I tend to be that way. So the last thing that's very important that we do is to choose phase. Now there's a few choices here. The last two affect the filter itself. The first four affect the target. The definitions can get a little confusing, and that's where the manual is very helpful. For right now, I'm going to choose phase equals input. I'm going to select that and hit send. The center two windows in Filter Hose now have the idealized filter, the magnitude response in red. And you can see the filter so far has not made any adjustments to the phase. And that's part of what we're after. We're looking in this case to do a magnitude only correction. So we now need to adjust the tap length and so forth. So we're going to move this to a Han 50%. And I'm going to start with a shorter tap length. We'll use 512 and we'll center it and set that and convolve. Our goal, as you remember, is that we want the phase to be relatively unaffected and only adjust the magnitude response. And you might see some of these ripples in the response here, and big ripples at low frequency. All of this is going to be subject to what we had chosen here while editing the filter. The smaller tap length means we have fewer points in this range to adjust for magnitude and phase. Even the magnitude is a little bit jagged in there. So just don't be alarmed by that. Just understand that that's relative to what you chose to edit the filter. So I'm going to go back to step three. I'm going to clear out these values, put in a longer tap length, center it again, set, convolve, and now you'll see that the response at the low end is a little less jagged. We've mentioned a couple things about graph settings, and we have up here on the top values from minus 15 to minus 65. We can right click on this, choose to copy the graph settings, come down here. When I do this, be mindful that the phase response is going to be not displayed because the top one doesn't have it. Doesn't mean it disappeared, it just isn't going to be displayed, but the range is going to adjust when I paste the graph settings. So now you can compare these a little more easily. Now you can see that the shape of the final response is very similar to what we had defined as our target. Now that the filter's been created and we can export the filter, now obviously you can follow the workflow by choosing step 5, or just remember you also have another way to get any of these graphs out of Filter Hose at any time, and that is you can right click on them. So this is my filter here. I can right click on this and export. In this case, I'll use a CSV file. We just completed doing a user-defined target. And in that process, the whole goal was to produce this particular curve here in the bottom right window. So we defined all along what we wanted that to be. Let's suppose we had a filter on another occasion that we had made previously, and we want to reuse it, but we want to modify it for some other purpose. So let's start with a whole new measurement and go through a user-defined filter. So I'm going to discard what I have here and bring up a new measurement. I happen to have some ETX files as my default here. There are many others, and we're going to use a CSV. We're going to bring up speaker 3 at 48K. And 4096. Now the next step here is to choose a user-defined filter, not user-defined target, which is what we did earlier. So you can see here that the magnitude response is displayed. The filter, currently in effect, is a perfectly flat gold or yellow colored line. I'm going to load the filter that I had built before to invert this response. I double click into the box here for the CSV file. I have to make sure that it is one that's compatible at 48,000 Hertz. And here's that file, speaker 3 filter. I'm going to open that, and Filter Hose is going to make the length match. Now notice, just as we did that, the filter loaded and the magnitude response is being shown accordingly. This can be bypassed and turned off. Turn it on at any time to see where you were and where you are now with your filter design. Over here we have a few parametrics that are filled out, but none of them have any gain. I'm going to modify one of these and use a spectral tilting technique. We're going to tilt this from 100 Hertz to 10,000 Hertz. And we're going to start here at 100. add 10 dB of gain, and we need a nice wide bandwidth to do that. And so now you can see that the magnitude response is predicted to rise that 10 decibels over that range. If I want to see just the filter I just defined, I can bypass the CSV, and now we're only seeing this one filter that I just loaded, and then layering that back on top of the CSV, I see the combination of those effects. Now there's one thing more we have to always keep in mind before we send this back to Filter Hose, and that is we have to make a choice here regarding phase. We're going to use the third choice here, which is to preserve the phase from the CSV file that we loaded and to set the phase for the values in the table to zero. This would be the table here where we set our filters up. The other choices are explained in the manual. We're going to use that for now and press send. And now we have this ideal response on the right, and we need to do our editing in step three. We're going to center this up and set that. Now notice this created a lot of processing delay. Slide this over and set it again and convolve. Now this may look funny at first because the range of my graphs don't match. Remember, I can right click on the top right graph. That's where I started. Copy the graph settings, paste those onto the bottom right, and we're in the same scale. And now you can see this spectral rise and a generally flat response through it. And of course our last choice is always to export the filter, and we'll call it speaker 3 filter new. So this concludes our introduction to some of the important advanced features that you'll probably use pretty frequently in Filter Hose. We sure hope this helps you with your work, and thank you for joining us.